let's invite our panelists on the stage. Please join me in welcoming Sukleen Aneja, CEO, Good Brands Company, the Good Glam Group. A very warm welcome to you, Sukleen. Sameer Sethi, VP and Head of Brand Marketing, Policy Bazaar. Dima Raketa, CEO, Reputation House. And the moderator for this session, Ms. Shweta Mulki, Consulting Editor, The Economic Times. A very warm welcome to all of you. Over to Shweta.
Yeah, I think a lot of you may not have created content, but what about buying from influencers? How many of you have been just influenced by influencers to buy things? Hands up, any hands up? Oh, we are kind of, are we in the wrong generation right now? But I'm sure you know about this space and you're curious to know where it's going to go. So a big welcome to my panelists here. In this session, we're going to delve into the factors behind the speedy but steady growth of influencer marketing. And it has sort of been anointed as a trusted voice, you know, with and credited with higher engagement rates, conversions, and improved brand sentiment. A lot of good things being said about it, basically. And we want to know whether that's all really true, whether there's a lot of depth in that, and how do we leverage this power? It's an industry that's said to be touching 2200 crores INR by 2025. I mean, I know these are numbers, but they seem like it's kind of poised for some rapid and major growth. So let me just start off with this kind of a headline assessment of where it is today. How is influencer marketing kind of having this impact on the new consumer today? What's your assessment of it? A quick one.
So I think for most of us who come from the new age brands, or if we look at traditional brands, I don't think anyone in the room can actually say that we've not seen influencer marketing as part of your marketing mix. So the biggest change I see is that in your 360 today, I think 100% of the brands will have a role for influencers, whether it's luxury marketing, it's SMEs, or it is mass marketing. So clearly there is a room for advocacy. That's one huge change that's happened. I think the second thing, which is also a remarkable change that we've all seen, and especially all those of us who've been working for a while, look at how large the creator economy is. Sometimes I feel every third person is a creator. You know, because you go to a restaurant, people are taking pictures of their food. So everyone in their own circle is trying to influence somebody. And there are these circles of influence, whether they are micro-influencing circles or whether you're a large macro which is trying to make a large impact. But I think everybody has deep interest communities that they are building based on who they are. So I think creator economy has given a lot of common people a voice. And that voice, I think, is really making a big impact in marketing.
Yeah. Quite true.
So I think till about 5 years ago, we used to hear about influencer marketing as this up-and-coming marketing channel, right, which can contribute just that tiny bit of incremental revenue or transactions.
Experiments,
for
they were called.
Sorry?
Experiments, they
were
called.
Yeah, yeah. So I think from up-and-coming, especially post-COVID, the share of influencer-driven business value has become quite meaningful for a lot of brands. It is not just something to experiment with, like you said. I'm even aware of some brands in certain impulse categories where the primary source of customers is in some form influencer marketing. And even for our category, which is very high involvement, slightly complicated to understand, takes a bit of time for a person to research and come to a decision of what to buy, where to buy from, and all of that. Even in my category, it is becoming increasingly meaningful, even at a ticket size of 20, 25K and above, which tells you about the trust that people lay in a lot of these creators, like Sukleen was saying. So yeah, I think influencer marketing has arrived. The debate now no longer is, okay, will it work, will it not work? It's just about figuring the right mix of your influencer marketing plan.
Right. Actually, I want to move on to also now more details like trends. I know backstage we spoke about what is really nascent and what is really kind of moved ahead. So I know that I read about social commerce, I read about micro-influencers, even nano-influencers as the smaller tier towns open up. What is your view on the next couple of trends that we will see emerging in this? I mean, you can touch upon either or something new.
We transfer mics to find someone working. Okay. Hello. In my personal opinion, for the last 10 years, the influencer marketing changed a lot. Now it is divided in different groups, in different categories, in different channels, and the technology emerging at the moment, and we don't know what will be tomorrow. In my personal opinion, the biggest opportunity and the same concern comes from artificial intelligence. Content creation will be never be the same in the next couple of years. And I don't know if the audience likes the content which will be created by AI, or they won't like. I don't think that anybody in this room has this answer, but we will see in the very, 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 very early future.
I think especially in the last couple of years after COVID, there have been a lot of category expertise that has come in into the influencer domain.
Yep.
I think earlier the mass volume was driven by a lot of these entertainment content creators. It still is to a large extent. But you now see a very, very large pool of, let's say, creators specializing in the areas like finance, health, wellness, even you know, fashion, and a bunch of these areas. So I think category expertise is the new trend that we are seeing, especially in the last couple of years.
Right.
And especially in my category, finance.
Right, right. Sukleen, what do you say about this? I mean, are micro-influencers really the smarter choice versus bigger marquee influencers on known platforms? I mean, is that the way forward now? It's kind of come to boiling it down to smaller and smaller kind of clusters.
The big trend around expertise. I think the second trend is also about nostalgia. People do want to bring back a lot of the past. The third trend, which I definitely see around, is, you know, expertise which is now moving beyond just product, but a point of view, you know. And lastly, even if you see the influencers who are actually trending big time,
right,
they all know their audience really well. So if someone is funny, he knows his audience, he knows what people are looking from him. They're almost capturing in 60 seconds a full-on package of entertainment.
Right.
Now, question of which influencer is right for you, I think it all boils down to what is the problem you're trying to solve. If you're trying to build expertise, then clearly you need to have someone who has an influence but also has expertise.
Right.
If your objective is reach, then it's impossible to do that without the nanos and the micros.
Correct.
If your objective is people who can actually give people inspiration, then you would do it very differently. And the other trend that I think if you see even in the way Bollywood is leveraging influencers today, look at how songs are traveling. Every single song now becomes a song that influencers do in their way, memes come up. So that's how they're becoming part of pop culture.
True, yeah.
So I think people are leveraging the capabilities that are there to solve the problems they wish to solve. And I think the difference between those who are doing it well and those who I think are still learning on it, I think is exactly that. How well do you actually understand the creator economy?
Right. But beyond that, are there any challenges when it comes to actually, I wouldn't say evaluating influencers, but let's say kind of fine balancing creators' trust that the audiences have in them and kind of balancing that with the company's values or the brand's values? I mean, that has always kind of been like a challenge. How do you now approach that?
You know, I think it's a little counterintuitive if I tell this in a room, and having been a marketer myself for most part of my career, I think, see, what we learned in our playbook was to always get the brand codes right, get the brand strategy right. But you know, the important thing is to realize that these influencers are not your brand ambassadors. They are not people who people want to hear because they are coming up to do an ad film for you. The reason why people want to watch their content is precisely because they don't do that, right? And I think the more we realize that it's important not to pollute their content, it's important, right? And I think it's a very difficult one. Because when the person who's given the job of creating the influencer content, typically a brand manager or a brand head in a business, he looks at it very squarely from the lens of my KPI.
Right.
But then you have to marry that objective with what's really the creator's audience.
Right.
You know, and how do you do it in a way that it really looks like he genuinely meant it? You know, you don't ever want them to have this feeling how typically you would see, like, so many people would always say, oh, really, Shah Rukh Khan, would he actually be using this?
Exactly.
You do not want that to happen to your creators,
right?
Because that's not a win-win.
Yes.
Not for yourself, not for the creator.
Absolutely. Sameer, you want to talk about that?
So, I think broadly there are two ways in which a brand can sort of integrate into an influencer channel. One is when the influencer or the creator uses the product as a consumer and then advocates it. I think there the only single lens we see is can the consumers or the viewers believe that this particular creator is actually using this? So for example, you know, a lot of times we see very, very wealthy celebrities advertising very low cost, value, popular brands.
Yeah.
A lot of times there's a believability issue there. So I think one is believability, authenticity. Secondly, there are creators who are advocating out of their authority on the subject. Say, for example, somebody who understands, say, for example, insurance really well. There, I think the only criteria is whether people accept their authority on the subject or not, because only if people accept the creator's authority on the subject will their word have any influence.
Right.
I think broadly these two criteria for these two specific uses. Apart from that, I think the basic check marks of being brand safe, etc.
Right. Dima, would you want to address how to kind of evaluate, how would you bring an influencer on board with your methods that you're kind of known for?
I want to add to previous topic one more thing. In the nearest future, we can see the rise of virtual mascots or virtual mascots of the brands. And with the rise of Web3, the rise of those technology, you know, in my personal opinion, we are at the border between when people like to talk to another people and when they start to love to talk to AI bots and mascots, virtual mascots and so on. Honestly, I'm on the side when I want to talk to people. But nevertheless, all youngsters, they hate when somebody calling on the phone and somebody talking to them, and that's all. About the collecting data. So for now, there are a lot of different web services and software where you can find out what is happening about you and your brand all over the internet, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and so on. You can collect all this data, analyze it, and understand what is happening in the moment. But the biggest advantage is that you can find out what is happening with your concrete, for example, influence marketing strategy. You can measure what is going on in the comments of the blogger or influencer. You can measure what do people discuss after the publishing and what they discuss in a week, in a month, and so on. So, as mentioned before, there are a lot of channels where you can grab the data. And yes, for now, it's not about, you know, somebody publish information about your brand or the history and so on. It's about what happens next, and you have to measure it, you have to collect it and understand what do people think about you and your brand, or maybe persona, or maybe event and so on, and what they will be thinking in the future, 7 days, 1 month and so on. Yeah, so collecting data is one of the keys to success, to understand the behavior of the users and of the audience which watches your advertisement in marketing. Yeah, that's it.
So I think different brands would be at different levels and in terms of their objectives, in terms of the way they work. So when Dima mentioned this about measuring, where do we stand on that today? Just to speak of return on influence, so to speak. Are the challenges the same that have been, let's say, a couple of years ago, or has there's been some kind of improvement in getting clarity on how the returns are coming in?
I don't think there's a very simple one-line answer to this. I think it's different for different categories, different platforms, etc. I'll give an example from my category. So insurance is not something people usually buy on impulse, right? They don't really, while browsing, encounter an insurance ad and say, okay, let me buy it. A couple of reasons, say it's a very complicated category to buy. So people need to be convinced about whether or not they need it. And secondly, you know, the ticket size usually tends to be high. In some cases, it can reach up to 20, 25,000, 30,000 rupees and so on and so forth. So this was the context, and we've seen influencer marketing working very differently across different mediums. So I'll give you an example on YouTube. A lot of people do their research before buying any kind of insurance on YouTube. There are a lot of searches on YouTube, okay, how to select the right term insurance. What cover should I get for my health insurance and so on and so forth, right? And there are plenty of creators targeting those keywords and creating content for people to understand the answer to these questions. So when it's intent-based, and you can also leave a link for people to click. We've seen it working very well. We've actually seen a lot of very clearly attributable sales happening because of such content integrations on YouTube, purely because it's intent-based. Whereas, you know, when it comes to a platform where people discover a lot of things and people are not usually searching for, you know, a lot of specific content, say, for example, something like a TikTok or Instagram and so on and so forth, there it has been a tiny bit challenging because of two things. Because you're basically serving the content to pretty much everyone who may or may not be inclined to even think about your category right now. So there's a lot of wastage there, number one. And B, the length of the content needs you know, tends to be relatively smaller. When people are looking to buy such a complicated category, they want to be very, very thorough with their research. They want to spend 10, 15 minutes understanding every aspect in detail, which they can do on YouTube. And secondly, the platform is designed in a way that there's no clickable link right there for people to click. And if you want people to go to the bio and then find the link and click it, you're adding one more step in the journey, which is a very cumbersome step for a lot of users, which also tends to limit the consumer response from a content integration. So I think that's where we are. When it comes to impulse categories, I've seen some of those platforms also working very well, but not so much for my category.
I think I'll go back to objectives again. If the objective is top of the funnel, then you may not have directly attributable ROI instantly, but you will see a distinct shift in the way consumers start perceiving your brand, right? But again, if it's a sales link campaign, if you're directing people to click-throughs onto a direct-to-consumer site or a marketplace site, your clicks are a very clear way to look at attribution. And if we are putting in the codes, you're giving the influencer codes there where people can shop from, then you can even link that to sale. Although my only submission on this one is that I'm not sure if there are too many organizations who would have tasted a lot of success in using influencers as a medium to sell. They are a very, very good medium to truly influence. And I think as long as we realize why are they doing what they're doing, I think we tend to manage the medium a lot better. Because if it becomes direct sales, then the whole process or the authenticity of it really starts to get compromised. You know, I mean, like, there are two aspects of it. One, I definitely would like to measure an impact on mind measures. You know, if through all the content that we were trying to publish, are the consumers genuinely more aware? Is the expertise actually getting transferred? Because, you know, today when people are buying into a product like insurance, which is a high ticket value, or if they're buying into skincare or makeup, which is high involvement category, people don't make the switch unless someone gives them an authentic point of view on why it's worked for them. So I think first thing for me is it really adding to that credibility that I like to build, right? And the second thing is, yeah, see, for all the brands which are selling to digitally native consumers, you are also looking at attribution. So if there is a large campaign one is doing, one would also like to see the impact it made to searches, to clicks, to sales, right? Because then at least it gives you enough confidence to want to invest more money behind it.
Thank you.
And we would like to measure our competitors. We want to study on their mistakes, because it is so easy to collect all the data about what is happening in their field, what kind of mistakes they did, and you can learn from that and do new mistakes.
New mistakes are always welcome. You can always learn. My last and final question is, of course, on AI, because there's a lot of marketers I've spoken to who feel that it might in the future have some impact. They don't really know how. They've been reading up, but they know that it's not. It's still very nascent. AI, perhaps generative AI has an impact on influencer marketing, but what are the issues you would like it to solve for? What would you like it to mitigate, if at all?
You know, if I can just say, if it can, you know, there are fakes are a big problem. If you can identify fakes and get remove that subset, because that dilutes the equity of those who are real, I think that's one big problem for it to solve for, if it can.
So I agree. I think ad fraud is one space. The other one, I think, is about measurement and attribution. A lot of things are being done manually. I think in some way I will be able to automate a lot of processes, etc. Also, I think, see, this is on the demand side of influencer marketing, right? Also, I have a feeling on the supply side of influencer marketing, in terms of actual creation and serving of content, and identifying what cohorts of people would like what sort of content, and you know, all of those spaces also, I think, will be revolutionized by AI in some way, generative AI, like you mentioned. There are plenty of human face creators, and then there are plenty of non-human face creators as well. There are pages which publish statistics, world statistics. There are pages that publish a lot of these graphic sort of content. A lot of that, I think, will sort of somehow benefit from generative AI. Maybe even human face creators in some way, you never know. I think we're only just starting in terms of AI. Let's see, you know, maybe in the next couple of years, let's see where we get, but I have a feeling there will be some kind of major impact.
So it's okay when generative AI helps influencers to simplify the process or find out something new in their analyze or measurement, something like that. But what if this generative AI will get into the bad hands? For example, just a kid or student can produce the content table for 200 and 300, 500 different groups and publics in Facebook and so on. He can add a content in a seconds there and publish it everywhere. And sometimes the organic user comes there, and who takes responsibility for the content published there? That's the one of the biggest issues.
My final one, just what kind of excites you in the next couple of years? Be it tech, be it just the power that you have with all these creators out there, what kind of excites you, just in a quick word?
I think there's so much that is still left unexplored, right? Like what programmatic can do, what the way attribution can be, measurability. In fact, even what Sameer mentioned on the supply side, how do we make it easy for creators to monetize? Because it's actually a humongous revenue stream for so many people who can monetize their worth. So I think in terms of possibilities, we're just literally scratching the surface. There's still lots that still needs to happen. And India is one market where you actually see people creating a lot of content, right? So I think in terms of possibilities, the possibilities are immense.
I think a couple of things could be very exciting. So especially again after COVID, we've seen a massive increase in the follower base of a lot of big creators. So there were plenty of creators during COVID who went from 10 million on YouTube, let's say, to a 20 million. Now there are a few. Back then you could hardly name maybe one. So I think a lot of these massive new creators becoming extremely big, some of them, in terms of their reach, are as big as a small TV channel. in terms of the actual number of impressions. So I think these mega creators, I think when they become sizable in number, is when we will see the real shift in ad spend. You know, Abhi, I think it's not even scratching the surface. I think there's a lot of room to grow. And secondly, I think I'm not sure if somebody is doing this already or not, but some edtechs, in a way, created a lot of online teachers by hiring them, teaching them how to, interact with kids online and teach them and so on and so forth, and created sort of armies of teachers. Maybe there's an opportunity waiting to be tapped by somebody sort of aggregating a lot of creators and creating new creators, creating new armies of creators. I think that could also make the space explode.
Suffice to say, there's a lot of headroom. Thank you so much, all three of you, for joining us. That's the end of the session. Thank you so much.